Hello, my dear students. Once again, we are meeting for the paper L3AO3 Shakespeare. And this presentation is meant for unit number 2, that is Merchant of Venice, Act 1. So in this presentation, we can have a detailed analysis of the Act 1 of Merchant of Venice with the following objectives. First, we can have an introduction, then the backdrop or the setting of the play, then the major characters as well as minor characters, then we move on to scene divisions, and then we can analyze each and every scene in an in-depth manner. That is, we have 3 scenes in this Act 1. So we can have a detailed analysis of all the 3 scenes in this presentation. At the end of the presentation, we also have some questions and then followed by references and discussion. So let's get into the presentation now. As you can see, the first part of introduction. In the 16th century England, it was reigned by Queen Elizabeth I, and this play is a 16th century play and was first performed in the year 1598. The composition of the play was not very clear, and it was believed to be written between 1596 to 1600. We are not very sure about the date of composition. And this play, The Merchant of Venice, deals with an important theme called anti-Semitism. We will discuss all the major themes in a later stage. Now, we will start with this particular theme since it gains relevance in Act 1 itself. So, we have to understand the backdrop in which The Merchant of Venice was written. From 1500 years back, Jews had been oppressed and they were not given equal rights. Nowadays we come across many racial problems throughout the world, and Jews also had faced such problems. So these Jews were chased out of Israel since they were not Catholic Christians. So this arises a discussion on the topic of diaspora. Jews were restricted from doing some certain businesses, and they do not have the proper permission to own lands on their own. They don't have property rights. Only except very few people were able to possess lands. But however, they were allowed to lend money and charge interest. And that term is called as usury or usury. Christians and Jews had always great conflicts between each other, and these Christians accused the Jews that they were making money out of other people's sufferings, misfortunes and debts. Since they collect interest for the money they have lent, these Christians accused them that they were making money out of other people's sufferings. This is a common charge against them. Christians also believe that Jews are mainly responsible for the death of Jesus Christ himself. It is a serious charge. That is why Christians started hating Jews altogether. Now, we move on to the backdrop. Again, a detailed description about the setting of the play. In the very title itself, as we can see, The Merchant of Venice, we understand the play takes place majorly in Venice. Shakespeare has chosen Venice for romantic and being a foreign location. It is famous for trading and a likely setting for rich merchants. And Jews were restricted in England. That is another reason. Shakespeare loved Rome for its classical nature. Rome still is a place worth visiting. And Venice is a business world a place of commerce and trade, but essentially it is a male world. From the major character Portia, that is the heroine of this play, we can understand she can live only in Belmont, not in Venice. Women were not allowed to move in Venice in a free way. So this kind of restriction was quite common in Venice. And many Puritans were unable to practice their religion, so they left England and they migrated to a new world. They started migrating to other countries, especially to other European countries. And this kind of oppressive nature of Puritanism can be equaled when we analyze the character of Shylock the Jew. Now we move on to the characters. We have around 23 characters here, starting from the central character Antonio, a merchant of Venice. Balthazar, I have given the list in alphabetical order. He is a minor character, a servant to Portia. Bassanio is an important friend of Antonio. He is a suitor to Portia. Clark, the Duke of Venice. Graciano is another friend of Antonio. Jessica is the daughter of Shylock. And Lancelot of Gobbo. Leonardo, Lorenzo is another friend. He is in love with Jessica. Nerissa is the maid of Portia. Old Gobbo. Portia is the heroine of this play. She is a rich heiress. Prince of Aragon, Prince of Morocco, they were all suitors to Portia. Celanio, Celarino, Celerio, they were all friends of Antonio. And we also have Bassanio, a servant, and most importantly, we have Shylock, a rich Jew, who is the anti-hero of this play. I don't call him as a villain, he is an anti-hero in this play. We also have Stefano, a servant to Portia, and Tubal, a Jew, a friend of Shylock. These are the characters in the play, The Merchant of Venice. Now we move on to the scene divisions in the play. As I already mentioned, Act 1 has only 3 scenes. And we can see the locations of the scenes. Scene 1 takes place in Venice, in a street. And scene 2 shifts to Belmont, that is Portia's house. And scene 3 shifts back to Venice, and now it is a public place. So we have only 3 scenes in Act 1. We can have an in-depth analysis of all the 3 scenes now. Now we have scene 1, in which we come across characters like Antonio, Celarino, Celanio, Lorenzo, Graciano and Bassanio. This quotation gains importance, just go through it. This is the opening line of the play spoken by Antonio, which reveals his character. He says, "In sooth, I know not why I am so sad. It worries me. You say it worries you. But how I caught it, found it, or came by it, what stuff it is made of, whereof it is born, I am to learn. And such a want which sadness makes of me, that I have much ado to know myself." These opening lines of Antonio reveal his character. He is introduced in the play, in the opening scene itself, as a sad man for no reason. He himself admits that he is sad, but he was not sure about why he is sad. So Antonio, as I mentioned, he is a very rich merchant in Venice. He need not be sad at all. He is very rich. But the reason for his sadness is not known to himself. So that kind of person is Antonio. He is basically a sad fellow. That is how Shakespeare introduces Antonio in the very first scene itself. Antonio complains to his friends that a sadness has overtaken him, but he is unable to say why. He is unable to find out the reason for his sadness. Celarino and Solanio suggest that it may be due to his commercial investments, business ventures. For Antonio has sent many of his business ships to various parts of the world. He has sent so many ships to various ports throughout the world. So that may be a worry for Antonio, detected by Salarino and Solanio. But Antonio rejects the suggestion, because his business does not depend on the safe passage of a single ship. He has so many ships, numerous ships. So he is not worried at all. That was not the reason for his sadness. Solanio again says that Antonio must be in love, a natural reason for a young man, but Antonio again dismisses the reason. Graciano comes here. He suggests that the merchant is worried so much about business again. This is the reason given by Graciano. This quotation by Antonio is an important one in scene 1 itself. You can just go through it. Antonio says his views about the world. I hold the world, but as the world, Graciano, a stage where every man must play a part, and mine is a sad one. All the world is but a stage, and all men and women are merely players. Same reference is made here. Shakespeare compares the entire world to a huge drama stage, and all the people living in the world are compared to mere actors. Here, the role of Antonio is a sad one, and he says, I am just playing my part, nothing more, nothing less. Now, Bassanio feels that Graciano's words are filled with nonsense. He is such an idiot and a fool, and he speaks full of nonsense. He says about his words, his speech is compared to 2 grains of wheat hidden in 2 bushels of chaff. So he speaks a lot of nonsense, and when we try to find some meaning in it, it is like trying to find 2 grains of wheat hidden in 2 bushels of chaff. This is a comparison made by Bassanio regarding Graciano's speech. Bassanio again reveals his love with a girl named Portia, a rich heiress from Belmont, and he hopes to win her heart by competing others against many wealthy and powerful suitors. Naturally, if a girl is of a very rich backdrop, there will be many suitors. Portia is extremely beautiful and filthily rich. So naturally, Portia has so many suitors. And I have chosen a particular quotation here which gains importance in the way in which Bassanio describes the girl in whom he is in love with. Look at the order of the description. First, I will read the quotation first. In Belmont is a lady richly lived, and she is fair, and fairer than that word, of wondrous virtues. Sometimes from her eyes I did receive fair, speechless messages. Her name is Portia. Look at the order in which he reveals about the love affair. When he describes the girl, he doesn't simply mention the name of the girl first. Look at the order. First, he mentions that she is extremely rich. Number 2, she is very beautiful. Only number 3, he talks about her character. She is of wondrous virtues. She is a virtuous lady. See the character of Bassanio. While describing Portia, we can see his priorities. He is choosing the girl for money, beauty, and finally for virtues. This is the character of Bassanio. Now, in order to woo Portia, it is not an easy task. However, Bassanio needs to borrow more money from Antonio. Antonio is a source of money. Bassanio has nothing left. So he has to seek the help of his friend. Antonio replies that all his money is locked up in his business ventures in the ships, but offers a guarantee and to lend any loan Bassanio can arrange. So Antonio is ready to offer himself as a surety for the loan Bassanio is about to get from any moneylender in Venice. That is the assurance Antonio is ready to give for the sake of Bassanio. That is the friendship between Antonio and Bassanio. And this line also reveals the character of Antonio, how he values friendship. At the same time, Bassanio's intentions and character are also quite suspicious here. He wants to borrow money, he keeps on borrowing money, and between friends, money doesn't matter. And Antonio is a man who readily is willing to offer immediate help. So such a character is Antonio. So from these lines, we can understand the characters of both Antonio as well as Bassanio. Now, at the end of scene 1, we have a detailed analysis. We have seen Venice, that is the backdrop of the play. It is a world of wealthy, upper-class Christian men residing in Venice. We have come across so many characters, they are friends of Antonio, and one of the major important characters, Bassanio. Antonio is lyrical and poetic rather than practical or business-minded. Usually, business people are very calculative, but unlike such people, Antonio seems to be a lyrical and a poetic fellow. And he has got so many friends and they sincerely try to cheer him up. When he is seen as a sad person, they sincerely extend their advice not to be very sad. So come on, cheer up. That's how they try to cheer him up. Antonio's friendship with Bassanio is quite sincere. From the lines we can understand, Antonio immediately comes forward to offer help in borrowing money. Since he could not help him personally, he is immediately coming forward to offer himself as a guarantee for any moneylender. So that is how he values love and friendship more than money. Antonio promptly offers all of his money and credit, insisting that they go straight away to a lender so he can stand as security or surety for Bassanio. Look at the noble nature of Antonio here. And Antonio is ready to take any risk for his friend Bassanio. From the scene 1, we can understand these aspects. So now, my dear students, we move on to scene 2. Now we are introduced to the heroine of the play, that is Portia. And in the opening scene itself, she describes the casket test through which she has to find a husband, because in that her dead father's will, the father has mentioned a competition or a test to choose the right casket in which the Portia's portrait is hidden, and the suitor who chooses the right casket with the Portia's portrait in it can marry Portia. And he has given 3 caskets. One is made up of gold, second one is made up of silver, and the third one is made up of lead. And the suitor has to choose the right casket in which Portia's portrait is hidden. That is the test given by Portia's father. He has written in his will. And Portia is seen in this scene as a wealthy heiress. At the same time, she is introduced as an independent and a strong-willed character. That is very important. Usually, rich girls would have been spoiled by their fathers. But it is not the case with Portia. She seems to be a wealthy heiress, at the same time, extremely a woman of strong character and a strong mental makeup. And we also get introduced to her close friend named Nerissa. And this particular dialogue is very important. She speaks, "Holy men at their death have good inspiration." This is about the father of Portia. She refers to him as a holy man. Therefore, the lottery, that is the test of choosing the right casket, that he has devised in these 3 caskets of gold, silver and lead, whereof who chooses his meaning chooses you. So that is how we understand that the suitor has to choose the right casket in which Portia's picture is hidden inside. We can also understand Portia's character as she is ready to follow the rules and regulations laid down by her dead father in his will. She is ready to adhere to the strict laws and strictures given by her father. And since she is very rich, there is an international level of competition among noblemen from various parts of Europe and even from Africa to win the hands of Portia. Portia's description of suitors serves as a satire on the noblemen of France, Scotland, Germany, and England. We have a list of suitors here, starting with Neapolitan prince. The comment given by Portia is followed. She says, "Aye, that's a colt indeed, for he doth nothing but talk of his horse." The Neapolitan prince is obsessed talking about his horse all the time. So she rejects him. She is not at all interested in him. And next comes a county palatine, and Portia again comments, "He doth nothing but frown, that is his nature, as who should say, if you will not have me, choose. He hears merry tales and never smiles." Such a moron is the county palatine, a dull-witted fellow. Again, she is not at all interested towards him. Next, we have a French lord named Monsieur Le Bon. And again, Portia comments, "He falls straight a capering, he will fence with his own shadow." He is such a vainglorious fellow, an egoistic character, who is a good-for-nothing character. Next, we have Falconbridge, who is the young Baron of England. Again, Portia says, rejects him. She says, "He understands not me, nor I him. He has neither Latin, French, nor Italian. Alas, who can converse with the dumb show? How oddly he is suited." He also makes an adverse remark on his way of dressing. So she also rejects a baron from England. Next comes a Scottish lord, and she commends him as a miser. And then here comes a German lord. She describes him as sober, a drunkard, and he is like a beast. Next comes Bassanio, the Venetian soldier and scholar. That is how Nerissa describes him. Nerissa calls him as a Venetian soldier and a scholar who looks the best among all the other suitors. And finally, she also announces the arrival of Prince of Morocco. But immediately, Portia says he has the complexion of a devil. That is how Portia comments about the Prince of Morocco. So we have come to the end of scene 2. Now it's time for a detailed analysis. In scene 2 of Act 1, we have seen a list of suitors who proclaim Portia's worth. Next, we come across the details of the father's will, in which how the suitors can win the hands of Portia, that is the casket test. And then we have the dilemma of Portia. Portia is torn between her father's will and her own will. She cannot make a decision on her own, but to follow the rules laid down by her father in his will and testament. So she is left with no choice. And followed by, there are many commentaries about Portia, about the suitors. And at the same time, we also get a hint about the love towards Bassanio. She is deeply in love towards Bassanio, and this kind of love is love at first sight, which is quite famous and common in all Shakespearean comedies. We have also seen the desperate nature of Portia, and this quotation reveals her desperation as we go through it. "If I live to be as old as Sibylla, an angel who dies as a spinster forever, I will thus die as chaste as Diana, another spinster, unless I be obtained by the manner of my father's will." So we can see the inner dilemma in the mind of Portia, whether to follow the will of her dead father or to make a choice on her own. Ultimately, she cannot go with the second choice. She has to adhere to the rules laid down by her dead father. This is the end of scene 2. Now we move on to the last scene in Act 1. Now the scene again shifts from Belmont to Venice, that is in a public place. We are introduced to one of the main characters in this play, next to Antonio. I would even say Shylock is the hero of this play, or the central character of this play. Shylock is a Jewish moneylender, and he agrees to offer a loan of 3,000 ducats to Bassanio for a term of 3 months' duration. He is a moneylender who comes forward to offer a loan to help Bassanio. Since Antonio has no money, he seeks the help of Shylock. Bassanio gives Antonio as surety, but Shylock initially was doubtful, as Antonio's wealth is currently invested in so many business ventures, and there is also a possibility of the ships getting wrecked in the sea due to storms and turbulences. So Shylock was not ready to believe the words of Bassanio initially, but later on he agrees. Shylock says, this quotation has been given since he calls him, it is good, he is a good man, Antonio is a good man. And Bassanio mistakes that Shylock is calling Antonio is a good fellow. It's not like that. Shylock says, my meaning in saying he is a good man is to have you understand me that he is sufficient. He is enough to be an assurance, to be a guarantee for the loan you are about to get. That is what he means by a good man and not referring to his character. That is how Shylock says. Shylock's hatred is quite visible in the next quotation also. We can see, as he says, that is, he refers to the Christians, I will buy with you, sell with you, talk with you, walk with you, and so following, but I will not eat with you, drink with you, nor pray with you. These lines very explicitly reveal the hatred of Shylock towards Christians, especially towards Antonio. In an aside, he makes a confession. Look at the lines here. I hate Antonio for he is a Christian, but more for that in low simplicity, he lends out money gratis and brings down the rate of assurance here with us in Venice. He spoils his business of money lending. Since Christians are not supposed to lend money for interest, Antonio keeps on lending money to his friends and destroys the business of Shylock. So Shylock was so upset about his character. And he says, if I can catch him once upon the hip, I will feed fat the ancient grudge I bear him. The word ancient grudge refers to the grudge Jews and Christians have towards each other. I told you it was a 1,500-year-old grudge between each other. The Christians essentially have forgotten the fact that Jesus Christ himself was a Jew. Only the followers of Jesus Christ were called as Christians, and Christ himself was basically a Jew by birth. Christians conveniently forget the fact and started fighting against the Jews. Antonio says, Shylock, although I neither lend nor borrow money by taking nor by giving of excess, yet to supply the ripe wants of my friend, I will break a custom. It is the custom of Christians not to borrow or lend money. But for the sake of friendship, Antonio is ready to break the custom, and he is ready to borrow money from Shylock. When Shylock makes a reference to a biblical story of Jacob and Laban, Antonio immediately says, mark you this, Bassanio, the devil can cite scripture for his purpose. Shylock casually makes a reference of the story of Jacob and Laban, but Antonio is so hateful against Shylock, he says, he calls him as a devil who cites scripture for his purpose. He calls him as an evil soul producing holy witness, and he is like a villain with a smiling cheek, a goodly apple rotten at the heart. Usually we cannot find whether the apple has been rotten or not from its external appearance. Some apples may be very shining outside, but they may be rotten inside. That is how he compares Shylock to an apple who is rotten inside. That is, in his heart he is evil and wicked. Oh, what a goodly outside falsehood has. That is how Antonio refers to Shylock's nature. Shylock starts recounting the insults meted out to him by Christians, especially by Antonio. He says, "You call me misbeliever, cutthroat dog, and spit upon my Jewish gabardine, and foot me as you spurn a stranger cur, a stray dog. Should I not say, has a dog money? Is it possible a cur can lend 3,000 ducats? Fair sir, you spit on me on Wednesday last. You spurned me such a day. Another time, you called me dog. And for these courtesies, I will lend you thus much monies." This is the opportunity for Shylock to pay back. Because Antonio has called him as a misbeliever, a cutthroat dog, and to add up to the insult, he has spit upon his Jewish gown, and he calls him as a cur, a stray dog, and now Shylock retaliates, has a dog money. Now why have you come to me for borrowing money? Now, can a dog lend money 3,000 ducats? That is how he asks. This is the time where Shylock can retaliate back. He makes use of the opportunity. And Antonio says, without giving up his ego, he continues, "I am as like to call you so again, to spit on you again, to insult you too." He is not ready to ask for any forgiveness. He says he would continue to insult him. "If you will lend this money, lend it not as to your friends, but lend it rather to your enemy." Look at the words of Antonio. For his selfish nature, he says, somehow he needs to borrow money, but he says, he requests Shylock, he is not even requesting Shylock, he orders Shylock to lend him money, not as a friend, but as an enemy. That is how he threatens to lend money. Look at the nature of Antonio. Shylock again strikes back. "If you repay me not on such a day, in such a place, that is within 3 months, such sum or sums as are, that is 3,000 ducats, expressed in the condition, let the forfeit be nominated for an equal pound of your fair flesh, to be cut off and taken in what part of your body pleases me." That is how Shylock puts a condition. If Antonio is not able to repay the money, that is 3,000 ducats, in 3 months' time, Shylock will cut off a pound of flesh from Antonio's body wherever he pleases. That is the condition he lays out in his bond. Such a cruel condition Shylock is offering. But Antonio and Bassanio have no choice. Immediately, without thinking about the consequences or thinking about the evil plans of Shylock, Antonio agrees. Now we come to the analysis of scene 3. We come across Bassanio's condition. He has no choice but to borrow money from the moneylender Shylock, the Jew. He is left with no option at all. He has to woo Portia as a suitor. And we have seen the hatred of Shylock towards the Christians in general and Antonio in particular. We have also seen Antonio's assurance to Bassanio that somehow he will help him. Shylock recollects the insults meted out to him by Christians, especially by Antonio. Antonio, we find breaking the custom of borrowing money from a moneylender like Shylock, as most of the Christians should not do it. But immediately Bassanio refuses the offer of Shylock, knowing fully well the character of Shylock. Shylock lays down so many conditions, and especially that condition is to cut off a pound of flesh from Antonio's body wherever he pleases. That is a very serious condition. And finally, we also see Antonio sealing the bond. That is how scene 3 ends. Now, at the end of Act 1, the presentation comes to an end, and students, this is the time for questions. I have given a list of 7 questions. Kindly go through them. Take these questions. Make use of the study materials available in the internet and as well as from other sources. Try to give answers to these questions and take it as an assignment. And for further reading, kindly refer the web links given in the description section of this video. And as usual, don't forget to join in the Google Classroom with the code mentioned here. Okay, see you, my dear students. See you in Act 2 of Merchant of Venice later. Bye. Take care.